Well, it's been a while since I've done anything with potted motors, like those found on a 201-2 or a 1591 or a couple of other versions of the 15. And when I did do my multi-part potted motor series, it was before I had the ring light that I'm using right now to help illuminate the subjects while I'm shooting the video. And recently a viewer had suggested it might be time to revisit the potted motor using this new lighting, and I wholeheartedly agree, because this will show the detail a lot better than what I was getting, you know, with a lot better results than what I was getting before. So having said that, what I've got on the bench here is a potted motor, a light, and a switch from my personal 1591. I should say my last personal 1591. I've gotten rid of all my other ones. This happens to be a machine that I'm going to keep. And it does need a good rewiring and cleaning. I've never opened this particular motor up, but it's time. As you can see here, the grunge factor is pretty bad on the existing grease. The wiring is definitely original, and I believe this machine was made in the early 1950s. I'd have to look up the serial number. I'm not exactly sure what the date was that the serial number was allocated. But regardless, it's off the machine now, and we're going to dig into it. So we're going to start off by taking the power block and disconnecting all the appropriate wiring. Now, being a 1591 versus a 201-2, it's actually a lot easier to do the wiring on this, because the or on power block, that is, because we're not fishing wires through the body of a 201-2, which can be a little bit challenging. On the other hand, this style light, I really don't like them. To the point where I might just replace this, because I dislike this particular light so much. But we're not going to worry about that light initially. What I'm going to worry about is the motor. If I do wind up reusing that light, I will do a separate video on the light. So we're going to put the light out of the picture at the moment, and we're going to worry about the motor. So we get this crap off of the power block, and I can see now that the insulation is really a lot worse than I'd even feared. It's literally peeling off in my hands. And we got our little brass washers, or some of them. Come on, get the last one off and get this ring terminal off. We're going to use crimp-on ring terminals in the rewiring process of this motor. Okay, we're going to start off with opening the body. There's two screws. Actually, I'm going to use a proper screwdriver for that. And I recently got an order in from Chapman. I bought a bunch of bits, which I haven't put away yet. So I bought like 30 in that last order. Okay. The appropriate bit. The nice thing about these Chapman bits, they will break before they destroy the screw head. They're designed to do that. And contrary to popular opinion, they're designed to do that not so that you buy more bits. They're designed to do that so you don't screw up the screws. All right, we'll get the cover off. All right, next up, we'll pull out the brushes. Be very, very gentle with these brush caps. If you break them, They're anywhere between $6 and $10 each to replace them. So use a proper fitting screwdriver. I've got this really nice big one here that I use for these. It's hollow ground. It fits these the screw under these really nicely. And just be somewhat gentle when you're removing all that. Okay, we'll take off the end piece, the end screw, get that out of the way. That doesn't want to fit that proper. So, all right, that'll fit. Okay. And open up the grease ports and pull the grease wicks out. And this is always so much fun and always so disgusting. Ta-da! And ta-da! All right. The good disgusting stuff is out. Now, let's find the location of the two set screws on the worm. Okay, found one of them, but I need a screwdriver that's going to grab that better. There we go. That's loosened. And spin that around. Or is that the same one? Nope, that's not the same one. There we go. See, hold on. Let me move this down a little bit. Okay, get that cleared out, backed up a bit, and back the other set screw up a bit, and we will extract, if we can, there we go, out comes the armature, and we have a disgusting mess inside, which we're going to remove and clean out. Loosen these screws. Okay. All right. Now, what I'm going to do, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to cut this wire right at the base here. We're not going to need any of that. That's all going to get replaced. I'm going to go ahead and push it back through. And while I'm about it, I'm going to take this decaying grommet, push that through as well. Okay. Shake out the debris. Now, I have a tool that I made a while back. You might have seen me use it before. This thing is just made out of some ultra-high molecular weight plastic. And I use it to tap out the brush holders. The brass tubes of the brush holders. It pops out. That one's not moving. Great. Okay. There it goes. I can feel it moving now. Now it's pushing. Alright, and that one is pushed through. As you can see there, it is pushing through. I'm going to extract that brush holder out the bottom. You got to be very careful you don't damage these, because it's very, very easy to do. These tubes can be very, very easily damaged. So, but this is the way I do it. I made this thing so I could push the tubes through. I'm actually, there we go. And that removes that. Now this, it's just a matter of taking off the component parts of the bobbin winder assembly, which then will allow the whole shoot and match to go to the sink. It's not the right one. This is the skinnier one. Okay. That doesn't want to give it up. Put on the wrench. There we go. And the wrench takes, once again, the Chapman wrench handle does the trick. And will this come off without too much trouble? Is the next question. Nope, that's going to want the wrench handle as well. There we go. Okay. That's off. And one last little piece that did not fall out. We've got to get the worm gear out, which is just right now suspended in a mass of schmoo and ooze. A disgusting mass of schmoo and ooze. Wipe some of that crud off. Okay. Now, before I take this to the sink, in deference to the fact that it's our kitchen sink and not a slop sink for just the shop, I'm going to take a quantity of cotton swabs and clean out the majority of the schmoo that's in here. Scoop it out, get it onto a paper towel, because for much the same reason that I wear an apron when I'm doing messy stuff like this, I am not going to be the one to let this crap go down my kitchen drain. Because while my wife is very understanding and very supportive of my activities, I don't think she'd be very happy with me if this went into the kitchen sink. And, so guys, I do recommend doing this portion this way. And when you get it down to a reasonable amount of schmoo, then take it in for the hot water and Dawn. Unless, of course, you've got a slop sink and it's your problem, or whether you, if you're single and you're living alone and you don't mind having this in your kitchen sink, which I can't imagine anybody not minding this. Even the most confirmed bachelor who is completely impervious to schmoo. All right, and push out stuff from here. And yeah, I don't mind using a lot of consumables for something like this. And believe me, I get crap from a lot of people on a lot of stuff. Oh, you use too many of this. You use too much of that. The blue paper towels are too expensive to use for that. Use regular paper towels. Yeah, okay. You work what works in your workflow. I'll use what I use. That's all right. Okay. The majority of the schmoo is off. These parts are going to the sink. I will be right back. Well, this was fun. This one took two passes through the sink to get the schmoo out of it. So I'm going to reset, put this off to the side, reset, get this crud out of the way, get myself a fresh, clean working surface down here, and then we'll go ahead and we'll rewire that. Before we get too deep, I've commented on these on the armature assemblies below about there usually being a fiber or a plastic washer. You can see there is a plastic washer here that is actually held in place by schmoo very close up to this flange. You can see it's spinning. Okay. If that doesn't want to break free because of surface tension, I'm just going to leave it sitting there, spinning in its schmoo. I'm not going to worry about it too much. I will endeavor to get it off. But what I'm going to do before I rewire is I'm going to take this commutator, or the whole rotating mass assembly, and I'm going to take this to the buffer, and I'm going to polish these commutator bars. So I'll be right back, and I'll show you. Actually, I'm going to do this a little differently. I'm not just going to buff it. I'm going to chuck this into the Jacob's chuck of my drill, of my bench motor, or I should say of my charming wife's bench motor, and I'm going to polish these in another method. Hang tight. Okay, I am back. That did not take very long. Let's see if I can get this to focus. You can see there's this line right here, a scoring line. That was pretty bad on these commutator bars. So I chucked this into the bench motor, and this is not the exact one I used, but I used a 600 grit nail file, and with the thing spinning at speed, I just applied a light amount of pressure. Not only did it take the crud off, but it leveled that out. So the brushes should contact that a little bit more evenly now. Plus, it had the nice advantage of polishing that up quite nicely. All right, let's get on with the wiring process. So this is, as it's sitting, this is the bottom, this is where it's coming out, that's where we're going to attack. And this is just a gooey mess. This is how it, not exactly how I was planning on spending my Saturday morning. And my apologies if you're hearing what sounds like a washing machine in the background. That's exactly what it is. But it is summertime here in the Northern Hemisphere. And I am in New Jersey, which tends to be rather warm. And because I can't have any fans or anything running, except for this ceiling fan, which is turning rather slowly as I'm doing this, and definitely couldn't run any air conditioners while I'm doing this, I have to have the door open. And so my apologies if you're hearing the laundry going, but we have a choice. We deal with the sound a little bit, or I wear dirty, stinky clothes. And my wife and I aren't about to wear dirty, stinky clothes. Sorry. Okie doke. Cleaning off a lot of this schmoo here, and that is pretty bad. And for those that say, you shouldn't use the blue paper towels, they're so expensive. Well, the blue paper towels are reasonably lintless, and they actually do help in the circumstance. So that's why I use them. All right, I'm going to twist this up to get a nice twist on that. and cut this excess off, and that's what we're going to work with here. Okay, we have, this is really a nasty one. I do have a monitor mounted on the wall now. I think I mentioned that once before. So it's a little easier for me to see what's going on. But once again, my apologies. If my hands get in the way, or something comes out of view, I do look up at that monitor every few minutes to get a better idea of what's happening. But I'm trying my best to make it so you guys can see easier what I'm doing here. All right, let me get a fixture of sorts put in place and get the wire, and we'll be back with a soldering iron once that warmed up. All right, I use this Stinger Select 18 gauge hookup wire, and I'm going to cut off far more of this than I need. I buy it in 250 foot rolls of hookup, which is more than enough. And I'm actually cutting this, gosh, I must have cut 20 inches for each lead. I cut way more than I need on this, but that's okay, because we don't know, I'm not sure exactly how I'm gonna utilize this in the end. So let me strip off a bit. There we go. Strip and spin. Strip and spin. Okie doke. And segregate that into two chunks. Like I said, it's way more wire than I'm going to need. But the way I buy it, it's relatively inexpensive, so I'm not overly concerned about it. Okay, now I will come in closer on this once I get this wrapped, and I'll show you how I wrapped it. But I'm going to get it wrapped first. And I think you'll understand why I'm going to come back in and show you after I wrap it. Or I'll hold it up, I should say, so I can show you after I get it wrapped. Okay. See how I have it wrapped around? It's a couple of passes. Okay, we'll let that sit there for a moment. Not exactly sure how hot my soldering iron is just yet. Okay, it's warming up. Now, let me zoom in a little bit on this. Come on. Okie doke. All right, now, the secret to soldering. Heat the work, not the solder. So I got the tip is tinned, meaning I melt a little bit of solder on the tip, wipe off the excess, let it heat up, let it flow. Okay. Now I'm applying the heat to the work where the wires are going to be joined. Let that get warm. Now this is like a 15 watt soldering iron, so it's going to take a while. This is really more for electronics than it is for this kind of wiring. So it's going to take a little while for this to transfer that amount of heat that's required. Then we just touch the solder to the joint after we've heated it up. Get that little excess blurb off there, and we're going to let that sit and cool. While that is cooling, I'm going to grab my big old spool of Raychem shrink tubing. This is the stuff I use, and you can see the size there. It's 1/8 inch, 25 foot spool, and none of these companies are sponsors, by the way. I don't have sponsors. Where I put my clipper. Here's my clipper. And we can see the length I'm going to need. So I'm going to just cut a little excess to that. So yeah, if you ever hear me saying, well, I use this, I use that, that is legitimately me just saying that's what I use. I don't get endorsements. I don't get paid by anybody for that. It's just me telling you from one sewing machine enthusiast to another what I like and what I don't like. Okay, we've got the shrink tubing in place. I'm going to grab my heat gun rather than use my torch. This heat gun is an old Craftsman I've had for close to 30 years. It will dim the lights, so I generally don't leave it plugged in. I'm going to shrink that down, and off it comes and out of the way. And we'll do the next solder. All right, we've got the first one in place. I'm going to go ahead, lather, rinse, repeat, and get the second one on. Okay. And once again, you can see I have it wrapped. Actually, focus. Come on, there you go. Focus, there you go. You can see I have it wrapped in place. I'm going to position this thusly, and actually, hold on. I want to try something here that I have never done before because I didn't have this before. I'm going to see if I can jam this in place and get something underneath here to get it not only at an angle you can see, but at an angle I can work. What can I jam under the front of it? Let's try this. Yay! I think that's going to hold. It's holding well enough. Okay. And I'm going to trim that a little bit after this gets soldered, that piece that's hanging out. I did have a little minor disaster a moment ago, and I dropped a tray of hardware, and the expletive has been already been deleted. This is, by the way, is like it's like a Charboy pad that's sold for cleaning soldering tips. Anyway, my charming wife came running to find out what the problem was, and when she saw, she's like, ooh. And she picked up all the hardware that just went dumping, and she carted it all off to the kitchen where she is being a true champion of sewing machine repair, and she's resorting all of it for me. That, gentlemen, is true devotion. All right, that's on. And yeah, that's gripping enough, so I'm just going to trim this off even. Okay. Now, I'm going to take a length of heat shrink tubing, shoring it down the line here. And you'll note I'm going to push that all the way up so it goes as far in as humanly possible. To the coils. All the way up to the coils. If that means forcing it, that means forcing it. All right, that is shrunk. Now, what I'm going to do, I've got a piece of larger tubing here that will accept both pieces of the wire. I'm going to run that up and shrink these two pieces together. You don't necessarily have to do this. I like to do it because I feel it stabilizes this considerably more, like that. Okay. And we'll shrink that in. Okay. Done. We take our new grommet and we insert our new grommet into the case. And we make sure it gets up and over the lip all the way around, which it's not doing at the moment. And it's which it is doing now. Okay, as you can let me see how you orient that. Okay, you can see the grommet is all the way around. I'm just going to put the zip tie is going to work against the grommet. I'll get it nice and tight, and I'll take my nippers, nip it straight across. There we go. Now we know the orientation. The brush tubes, we never changed the position that the brush tubes came out, and we know that this is going to be the bottom corner because that's where that's going. So we'll feed our wires through the grommet vomit. Okay, that was a little bit of humor, not much. Granted, very little. And get that properly oriented. And we will insert our brush tubes back in the brush tube holders, which can be a bit of a challenge at times. Actually, before we do that, hold on. Hold one. Let's clean these brush tubes out. Let's get in here with some cotton swabs. Get some of the schmoo out of there on both sides. And what we're also going to do, I'm going to make sure that we didn't distort, which we didn't. The brushes are fitting nicely through the tubes. Okay, this one's a little tight. That means that getting this out, this one got a little bent. So while we have it out where it's easier to work on, I can see where the bend is. I'm just going to take these bent needle nose pliers and re-flatten that surface. And yes, the brush drops right through it now. Okay, we're good. Okay, so brush tube is going to go back in. Once again, this is so much easier for me to do when I don't have to try to make it so you can see what I'm doing. Get the other one oriented correctly. And the wires to the brushes, by the way, they're fine. I've only had to replace one or two of these over the years. These are generally in good shape. Okay, that's back in. Okay, now we're going to put the retaining screws back in. And we don't have to hold this thing together again for the rest of our lives. The rest of the orientation. Okay, very good. Our next step is going to be getting a clean paper towel down. All right, you'll note on the armature, shaft, there's a ground area that is going to receive one of the two set screws that's on the worm. Easy to find that ground spot on the back end of the armature. There's an area here that's cut flat. That corresponds with the location in terms of rotation of where that ground spot is. So, all right, we're going to just drop the worm in, get it between the centers of the bearings there, or the bushings there. Now you notice that just dropped all the way in. We're never going to be able to push that shaft in, so we're going to stick a small skinny screwdriver in, hold it up, and hold up that worm. Then put our armature in and juggle that screwdriver around until bada bing bada boom, the armature slips all the way in. Now we're going to rotate. Something's interfering here. I had interference, so let me That was my interference. My strain relief was interfering. All right, let's try this again. All right, that's why it helps to check your work as you go. All right, we get it back in. Spinning, no interference anymore. All right, now we're going to put that flat spot here oriented so that we can get a set screw visible up here, pretty much aimed at that flat spot, and then just start screwing the screw in, and then we'll turn while putting our thumb over that over the worm, and we can determine, yes, in fact, the screw has found the groove. Tighten that up, rotate a few degrees to get to the next set screw, go in there, tighten that up, spin it, bada bing, bada boom, that's ready to rock and roll. Okay. Everything else is pretty straightforward. We can put the end cap back on now. Actually, I'm going to clean that up. Old one. Okay. Cleaned up the end cap screw. It's nice and shiny now, but also a little bit of chowdering that happened to it is gone. We don't like chowdered screw heads. So, we can stick it on there. Get it on there nice and tight. Okie doke. Next up is going to be cleaning the grease wicks and the grease wick holders and the springs. So these are pretty disgusting. These wicks are rock solid, so they go right to la trash. And we'll take some cotton swabs once again, knock out some of the schmoo. Actually, knock out all of the schmoo. And this particular clip looks a little damaged. It's a little bent, so we're going to do some repair work on that. We're going to get in here, we're going to straighten that out. Okay, that's much better. And another cotton swab in here. Get the schmoo out. Yucko. I'm going to take these to the kitchen sink once again and get rid of the grease. I'll be right back. Okay, I buy my wick from McMaster Carr. It's just felt wicking material. I buy like 10 feet at a time, which is a ton, believe me. It's not expensive at all. There are sellers on eBay and a couple other places online that will sell you a kit to rewire one of these potted motors. You'll get a couple of pieces of wire, you'll get a few inches of, or two pieces, about an inch and a quarter long of the wick material. They'll give you a couple of little chunks of shrink tube. You know, everything you need to actually do one of these potted motors. And they'll charge you about, $15 to $20 for the pleasure. Believe it or not, even though that's a lot more than what the materials cost, if you're going to be buying it in bulk, that's a lot to do a lot of them. If you're just doing one motor, it can make economic sense to buy those. So I'm not going to say anything negative about any of the entrepreneurs out there who are selling this stuff. I think they're offering a good service. And like I said, if you're only doing one of these motors, it does represent a decent deal, because then you know otherwise you're stuck with a bunch of this stuff. All right, I put a little bit of the So Retro grease, which I get from the Featherweight shop, put a little bit on the end and down in the hole right on the shaft where the wicks go. So I preload just the area of the shaft and I stick a wick in the hole, and then using a pair of needle nose pliers, gently squeeze the holder together and then press it down and in place. You gotta be very gentle when you're doing this. If you are rough with it, you will break the retainer, the little metal retainer, and then you're screwed. You either then have to fabricate one or try to repair what you have damaged, neither of which is a fun alternative. I know, I've done both. Okay, we get that second one in there. Then we take our So Retro grease and we inject, and we stick it in. I used to use the white grease that Singer sells, the Singer motor lubricant. I used to use a lot of that. I have changed over to using the So Retro grease. I don't know if it's any better, any worse. Both of them work equally well. All right, and then shoot a little bit onto the gear, spin the gear around, get a quantity onto the gear, I should say. Now, I did a video where I talk about redoing the hand wheels, the balance wheels on these machines, where I dissected them. I showed you how there's a couple different styles. I'm going to refer you to that rather than run the whole thing right now, doing it again, because it is pretty simple. And otherwise, we'd be kicking a dead dog and nothing to be moving but the fleas. So, when you put your brushes back in, notice the orientation of the curvature of the brush. Insert it so that it matches the curvature of the armature and the commutator bars. And of course, start your brush caps gently. Always be gentle with brush caps. They are expensive. They are hard to get. Alright, matching that curvature once again to the rotation of the motor. And gently getting that brush started back down the hole. Okay, and there it goes, it's down the hole. And brush cap. You know, for a guy that just went to the sink and degreased a couple of parts, my hands are pretty filthy already again. This is one of the reasons why when we do these motors for other people, we charge money for them. Because my God, it's a filthy job. Little trick for getting these covers on is to start the screws on both sides before you slip the cover in place. Just start the screws. And to start the screws, a good trick is to use these claw type things. Makes life easier. Just get it started. Claw up the next one. Flip it around, get it started. Okay, now when you slip the motor cover on, the screws are right there, bada bing, bada boom. It's just a matter of running the screw in. And I'm not going to super tighten these at the moment. Just running the screw down to make contact. So if you're wondering why I left so much wire on this, especially seeing how it's going to be going onto a power block. The machine that this is going to is nowhere close to being put back into service, and I did want to test it. So I left enough wire on there. I'm going to put a plug on this, a standard wall plug, and I've got a regular controller that uses that has the duplex receptacle, and that's how I'm going to test this. So give me a second to put a power plug on it. Okay, we are plugged into a power block and an electronic foot controller. And we're slinging grease around inside now, which is a good sign. And there we go. There you have it. Bob's your uncle. Okay, the only thing that's left now to get this motor back in service is to reassemble the bobbin winder and put it back on the machine. Unfortunately, the 15-91 that this is intended for isn't even close to going back into service yet. So, but at least we know that when the mechanical portion of that machine is ready, the motor electrically is ready to rock and roll. So that's it for this episode. Thank you so much for watching, and we will see you on the next one.